You can see here, what does the blue represent? Ectoderm, okay? Sometimes there will be slightly different shades of blue depending upon whether it's ectoderm or whether it's going to be skin or neurons or whatnot. What's the red again? Mesoderm. And what's the yellow? Endoderm. So again, look at how much red there is. There is a lot of components that are mesoderm derivatives, whereas the skin and the nervous system are the primary derivatives of the ectoderm. The endoderm actually doesn't form till much later on. You know, once a lot of these things form, then you start forming some of the rudimentary structures of the digestive system and the respiratory system. The respiratory system is, in fact, the last organ to develop, the lungs. In fact, scientists are finding now in development that that's one of the things that triggers childbirth, is there's a chemical that's released once the lungs are developed that will initiate childbirth. It's basically the timer on the oven. You're done, you know, essentially. So, blood, heart, kidneys, gonads, bone, muscle, connective tissues. See how the mesoderm is quite a substantial number of derivatives. Ectoderm, the epidermis, which is the skin, and then the brain. And when we say nervous system, we include spinal column and all essentially peripheral neurons, all neurons that innervate your muscle and your skin and, you know, the parts of your body. And then, of course, endoderm is the digestive system and its associated organs, such as the liver and the pancreas and whatnot, and then the lungs. In fact, it forms as just one long tube, and then from that, you get the various parts budding off from that endoderm to form the various organs. It's very fascinating. At least for me, it is. So, now, there are some structures as we go through here that are called transient structures. And what we mean by transient is they'll form these layers, but they eventually they'll dissolve. They won't incorporate themselves into the embryo. Now, the notochord is one of these things that people tend to confuse because they think notochord and they think spinal column. In reality, the notochord is one of these transient structures. Now, we are finding that where the new book comes into play, some of these cells don't all go away. Some of them actually get incorporated into the vertebral column of the spinal cord. But the notochord itself is kind of a patterning structure where it patterns most of the germ layers around it, and then the notochord, when it's no longer needed, essentially disintegrates and it's gone. So not all layers of tissues that you're going to see, even though they have their derivatives in, say, the mesoderm, the notochord has its derivatives in the mesoderm, won't always become part of the embryo itself. And again, you can see the coloring here, the blue and the yellow and the red. So this just kind of shows you a cross-section of the various germ layers that are forming. Again, the blue forming the ectoderm. That's really how the brain and the spinal column forms, is the ectoderm will essentially create this fold and then fold over, and then that tube, which we call the neural tube, will become the brain and the spinal column, and then the remaining ectoderm will become the epidermis or the skin. The next layer, the mesoderm, that forms all of those other structures, the muscle, bone, heart, blood, cartilage, connective tissue, gonads, kidneys, it's everything. And then the endoderm, again, which is the lowest layer here, the digestive and the respiratory. Again, the notochord, even though it's red because it originates from the mesoderm, is one of those transient structures. It's necessary for patterning of almost all the tissues around it, and then most of it dissolves. But some of them will become part of other structures. The last concept that we need to go over is fate mapping. Now, fate mapping is one of those processes that has a number of ways in which you can approach it. Now, again, you're seeing the same colors that we went over before. We have a zebrafish here, which is the actual scientific name is like Dibrario. Frog, which we call Xenopus. Mouse, which is Musculus. Funny one. Chicken is Gallus. Gallus gallus or Gallus domesticus. So these are some of the organisms we use when studying vertebrate development. Notice they all have different what we call fate maps. So what does is a fate map? Well, a fate map is these areas haven't actually become the germ layers yet, but we've shown by following these cells that this portion of the embryo will contribute and eventually become the ectoderm germ layer. This region will eventually become the mesoderm, and this region will eventually become the endoderm. So in these earliest stages, you can see that even when there's only a few cells, that already the embryo is patterning itself. We've shown by a number of mechanisms that even in the earliest stage as a single egg, there are portions that are fated to become the ectoderm, or the mesoderm, or the endoderm. We assume sometimes that an embryo is universally the same throughout, and it's not. In fact, in most cases, when we create, when women create the oocyte, they actually create regions that have RNA sequestered to them, to that region of the embryo, or RNA sequestered to another region, so that during the cleavage process where the cell is dividing and undergoing mitosis, it's already got different genes that are ready to be transcribed, or they're already transcribed, ready to be translated, and then those proteins will create different areas of the developing embryo. So an oocyte is not universally the same. You've got RNA here, you've got RNA there, you've got part of the cytoskeleton that creates different polarities. Even the yolk itself, which is the nutrient portion of the oocyte, in the frog embryo, we have what's called the animal pole and the vegetal pole, where the animal pole has a tremendous amount of yolk that actually prevents these cells from creating smaller cells, and the vegetal pole has less yolk, and so the cells are able to divide much more rapidly, and that's kind of what's illustrated in this right here. Yeah. Let's talk about how fate maps are done. There are multiple ways to be able to look at how an embryo, how the cells move where they're supposed to move. And each one has their advantages and disadvantages. For example, in some embryos, the cells are naturally colored or different from one another. So you don't have to do anything about it. You can actually just watch the embryo divide, and you can see where some of the cells are going because there's a natural coloration of some of these cells. So in some cases, we don't have to do anything when we watch these embryos grow. But in a lot of cases, you really can't tell just by looking at the cells. You can't follow the cells. And that's really what fate mapping is all about, is following where those cells go in the earliest stages of development. So one of the things we can do is you can put a dye in it. So that's what vital dye marking is you can inject a dye. That really doesn't affect the cell too much. There are some dyes that are better than others. And then you can follow the cell. But there's a problem with this. As the cells grow and divide, what do you think is going to happen to the dye? It gets diluted. So there's only a certain point in which you can follow the cells and their derivatives with the vital dye marking. Okay? So that's a limitation to this marking. Now, radioactive labeling pretty much does the same thing as the dye. It's a way of tagging a cell based upon a radioactive isotope that gets incorporated into the cell. But again, you follow the same problem. It can go longer because it's much more sensitive. So radioactive labeling is more sensitive, and so you can follow the cells a lot longer, even though, again, you start getting the radioactivity diluted as the cells grow and divide and undergo this process. Fluorescent dyes are kind of right up there with radioactive labeling because, again, these have such a high spectrum in which you can see even just a small amount of fluorescence that, again, when you inject fluorescence into an embryo, you can follow them in that regard. So vital dye, radioactive, and fluorescence, in that order, have longer and longer time periods in which you can follow the cells. If you just label a cell with a dye and say, okay, well, where does it go? You can just follow them longer and longer with that. Now, the one that can be permanent is the genetic marking. Okay? Genetic marking can be absolutely permanent. Now, there's two ways in which you can do this. The first way is genetic embryology, such as transgenics. You pretty much just put a gene into the cell's nucleus, and every time it copies its genetic information, it will copy that gene as well. This is what we do when we say insert a GFP, a green fluorescent protein, to tag a cell. Or you can put another type of genetic marker in there. The long and the short of it is, you can put a gene that can be permanent in the cell's nucleus, so that every time the cell divides, it won't get diluted, because it'll copy that gene, and then that will be part of every cell's fate from there on. The other way in which this can be done is you can actually do an experimental approach using genetic marking. Let's go back to that, and let me show you how. Let's look at here. A transplantation experiment can be used for genetic marking. Let me explain how that's done. This is typically done between different species. So let's say you use a quail and a chick egg. If you take cells from a chicken and put it in a quail, or vice versa, they have enough genes in common that the cells will behave as they normally should. However, there are subtle differences in the quail genetics versus the chicken genetics, in which case, after a certain point in time, you can use some type of chemical detection or fluorescent detection to see which cells have that gene that would not be found in the chicken embryo. So you can actually trace the lineage of quail cells based upon the uniqueness of the quail genetics. So you can actually do genetic marking with either one of these. You can do it with transgenics, where you actually put the gene in it and then follow the ancestry of that, or the genealogy of that cell. Or you can take cells from a closely related species, and it behaves fairly the same, almost identical to the others, and you can actually then look at the genetics that are different in, say, the quail cells or the chick cells.